Glory be to the Lord's holy name. We got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Luke chapter 7. We shall read from verse 11 to 16. Luke chapter 7, we shall read from verse 11 to 16. And it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and much people. Now when he came nigh to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and much people of the city was with her. And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said unto her, Weep not. And he came and touched the bier, and they that bare him stood still. And he said, Young man, I say unto thee, arise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak, and he delivered him to his mother. And there came a fear on all, and they glorified God, saying that a great prophet is risen up among us, and that God hath visited his people. Verse 11, let me read again. And it came to pass the day after that he went into a city called Nain, and many of his disciples went with him, and much people. And now when he came to the night to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and much people of the city was with her. A very powerful passage in the Bible. But except Luke, the other evangelists have not recorded this passage. Matthew gives a reference to this instance. The Godhead of Jesus was perfectly revealed in this passage than any other passage. In the scriptures. Here we read this passage, it came to pass the day after Jesus performed the miracle of healing the servant of the centurion. The very next day, he went into a city called Nain. The city was in between Galilee and Jerusalem. Is on the way from Galilee to Jerusalem. It was in the province of Galilee. It belonged to the tribe of Issachar. It's a very beautiful, lovely city. The little word Nain means green pasture. Pasumai pulvali, green pasture. And also the word Nain means beautiful, lovely. So the city was called beautiful, lovely. It's on the slopes of a mountain called Little Hermon. And very close to the mountain Tabor. I don't know whether it was a prophecy or no. In Psalm 89 verse 12, there is a reference to this mountain Tabor. The north and the south, thou hast created them. The north or the south, thou hast created them. It was Tabor and Hermon, two great mountains, independent mountains. The north and the south, thou hast created them. Tabor and Hermon shall rejoice in thy name. This great miracle was literally happening between Tabor and Hermon. And this mountain was called, where this Nain was situated, as a little Hermon. A little Hermon, a beautiful place. So Jesus was coming into that city. With Jesus, his disciples were there and much people, the entourage of Jesus Christ. A great number of people, they were coming to the city, they were coming to the city. So this procession was coming into the city. At the gate of the city of Nain, this group, this entourage, met another procession. In that city, there was a widow. That widow had only one son, and he was a grown-up boy, a young boy, 18 plus, the young man. They had a usage of the word, when a young man, he must be certainly 18 plus. So this young man, the only son of that widow, he died. We don't know how the death came. He died. The time came. They are carrying the body to be buried. Generally, the burial ground will always be outside the city. The burial ground will always be outside the city. So this is outside the city. They are taking the body to be buried. They are taking the body to be buried. Generally, women will not go for the burial. But there was not a Jewish rule that they should not go. But generally, they don't go. But this widowed mother was weeping and going behind the bear. She was not going alone. Much people of that village, her friends, her relatives, the boy's friends, relatives, they all are going with her for the funeral. So it was very interesting to see one procession was coming from without the city, one procession was going to without the city. From without the city to without the city, to outside the city. At the gate of city of Nain, at the gate of green pastures, at the gate of beauty, at the gate of lovable, lovely, these two processions meet. I'm able to see a beautiful contrast. One who said, "I am the life," is coming into the city. And the dead man was going outside the city, is taken outside the city. One who said, "I am the resurrection," is coming into the city. And one who is taken for burial is moving outside the city. Death and life, burial and resurrection, they meet one another at the city of gate. Light was coming in, darkness was going out. The star of hope is coming in. People with no hope, they are going out. Just imagine the powerful, electrified situation. Death and life, resurrection and funeral, light and darkness, the star of hope and the people with no hope, they are meeting one another at the city, at the gate of the city of Nain. At the gate of the city of green pastures, in that beautiful place, lovely place, a small city on the slope of Little Hermon, meeting one another. My dear brother, my dear sister, something wonderful takes place in that city. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. We read verse 13, "And when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said unto her, 'Weep not.' And he came and touched the bear, And they that bare him stood still. And he said, Young man, I say unto thee, arise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak. And he delivered him to his mother. My dear brother, my dear sister, almost yesterday I was totally broke. All through the past 1 week, maybe the Lord permitted it, I'm hearing problem after problem after problem. We have come for the ministry. Not only people from our church, servants of God, even others, those who don't attend the ministry here, came with problems, broken down, weeping. Yesterday from another country, one young man phoned me and poured out his heart. You may not believe, his pain and agony was so much that he spoke to me over the phone for 4 hours nearly. I know the Lord has called us for this ministry. The Lord has called us for this ministry. We have to bear the pain, the heartbreaks on our shoulders. The Lord has called us for that. My dear brother, my dear sister. Nevertheless, it is too difficult at times for us to bear. Sincerely I prayed, Lord, this morning be a morning of the city of gate, where life and death meet, where sorrow and rejoicing meet. Let the sorrow of the people be turned into rejoicing, O Lord. Let their mourning be turned into rejoicing, O Master God. Let the bitterness in their life become sweet, O Lord. My dear brother, my dear sister, I was waiting in the presence of God and preparing this powerful message. It is something that I have preached in many other places, maybe for a special meeting, for a convention. But this morning, last night the Lord burdened me that I should speak this to the church. 7 things what Jesus did, I'm going to share with you. Truly, let this morning be a morning where death and life meet, where sorrow and rejoicing meet, where the star of hope could meet the people with no hope. A morning where your tears could be turned into rejoicing. Very briefly, I'm going to share with you 7 things what Jesus did at the city, at the gate of the city of Nain, that could change a sorrow into rejoicing. Number one, it's a very simple thing, it's a basic thing. Jesus saw her. Jesus saw her. There are many people. A huge crowd was coming with her. But the omniscient eyes, all-knowing eyes of Jesus saw her. If you read this passage carefully, it records they carried the dead body. And the woman was coming behind her. The Bible doesn't say Jesus saw the dead body. The Bible doesn't say Jesus saw the bear carriers. The Bible doesn't say Jesus saw that crowd. There was a much crowd. But Jesus was not concerned about that crowd. He was not concerned even about the dead body. Jesus saw that woman. Jesus saw that woman. He knew the pain in her heart. My dear brother, my dear sister, there can be 10 people, 100 people, 1,000 people. If Jesus could see you, if the eyes of Jesus could fall on you, a miracle will surely take place in your life. Zacchaeus was sitting on the sycamore tree. Jesus saw him. Nathanael was sitting under the sycamore tree, fig tree. Jesus saw him. Jesus saw him. There is a very powerful meaning. If Jesus could see us, his eyes would fall on us. Literally mean that Jesus could understand us. If Jesus could know the path in which we are going through, the reproach we are bearing, the pain in our hearts, if Jesus could see that, the miracle will surely take place. The miracle will surely take place. Number two, and when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her. His eyes affected his heart. When the Lord could see how much you suffer, when the Lord could see your tears, surely that would affect his heart. Once Jesus told Moses, "Moses, I have seen the sufferings of my people because of the taskmaster. I have seen the sufferings of my people because of the taskmaster. In மக்களுடைய உபத்திரவத்தை பார்க்கவே பார்த்தேன் ஆளோட்டிகள் நிமித்தம். When the Lord could see what pain we bear, through what type of a trouble we are going through, the path in which we are going through, others may not understand. Your husband, your wife may not understand. The path in which you are going through, your children may not understand. The Spirit of the Lord is speaking to you. Your own mother, your own father, your own wife, your own brother, nobody is able to understand me. How much I suffer. Day and night I suffer. Nobody understands me. I don't know for whom I suffer. They don't have any pity on me. There is a beautiful Tamil saying. The father said, "Oh, we don't have clothes to cover. Mooda thuni illa." The son said, "Iluthu moodu pa. There is no cloth to cover. Somehow stretch forth and cover. This is my yearning. This is my suffering. My wife is demanding more and more. My parents are demanding more and more. Our children are demanding more and more. I don't know where I can go. There's nobody to see me." The Lord saw the suffering of his people because of the taskmaster. The suffering of the mother because of the children. The sufferings of the husbands because of their wives. The sufferings of the wives because of their husbands. Sufferings of the parents because of the children. The pains. When the Lord saw that, it moved his heart. What he saw affected his heart. He moved with compassion. The Greek word for compassion is very beautiful. Compassion. Compassion means empathy. Feeling as you would feel. Have the same passion what you have got. Sympathy is feeling sorry for somebody. Empathy is feeling sorry with somebody. He is able to see you as you see you. He is able to feel the pain as you are feeling the pain. We are worshiping a God who is always moving with compassion. In the Bible, in the Old Testament, we see this phrase, full of compassion. Jesus is full of compassion. In Psalms alone, I love to show you the passage, possibly you can make a note of it. In Psalms alone, in 78:38, in 86:15, in 111:4, in 112:4, in 145:8, Psalmist says again and again, you are full of compassion. What does it mean, full of compassion? Compassion, how you feel, he feels. Compassion, the same passion. It moves his heart. In Tamil, the translation is very powerful. Manam urugudhu. His manam, his heart begins to melt. Probably when you are suffering, the husband's heart may not melt. Your manager's heart may not melt. Their taskmasters, the team leader's heart may not melt. The way you are suffering, working, slogging day and night, even the heart of your own mother may not melt. Manam urugudhu. As soon as he could see our sufferings, his heart melts. In about Jesus, we read in Matthew 9:36, Matthew 14:14, Matthew 15:32, Matthew 18:27, 18:33, Matthew 20:34, Mark 1:41, Mark 5:19, 6:34, 8:2, 9:22, Luke 7:13, 10:33, 15:20, a few passages. Why I just give this reference? Again and again, when Jesus saw a leper, when Jesus saw this widow of Nain, when Jesus saw people suffering with diverse sicknesses, when Jesus saw people, the sheep without shepherd, whenever Jesus saw people in difficult situations, his heart moved with compassion. It started melting. That your suffering was the fire that melts heart of Jesus. Many years ago, I remember it was in Martanda. I was preaching in a convention. I said, when Jesus saw her, he was moved with compassion. The anointing of the Lord came upon me mightily. So many funeral processions I see. The widow going behind the dead husband. The husband going behind dead widow. Parents weeping over their dead children. Children weeping for their parents. How many times our hearts are moved with compassion? How many times your manam melted with compassion? How many times that fire, that agony, the suffering of other people have moved our hearts? Many times what we see don't affect our heart, but we are worshipping a mighty God, a loving God. God who created universe, heaven and earth. His heart is not a stony heart. When he could see people suffering, his heart moves with compassion. My dear brother, my dear sister, in Isaiah chapter 54 verse 10 we read, the mountain shall depart and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee. My kindness shall not depart from thee, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, say the Lord that hath mercy, or that hath compassion on thee. Mountains may be moved. Mountains may be moved. Hills may be removed. My dear brother, my dear sister, husband, first his wife ran away. Wife took the children, all the wealth, ran with somebody else. Mother, leaving her husband, children, ran away. We trusted somebody like mountain. Mountains were removed. We depended on our children. Our children moved away, departed. You are in this old age. I trusted, I thought that they could help me. The staff that I could lay on them. This widow's son passed away. Her only hope was lost. Darkness shrouded her. Mountains will depart. Hills will be removed away. But the covenant of my peace and my kindness will not depart from you. It will not leave you, saith one who has got compassion on you. How did this sorrow become rejoicing? How could the death become life? The very simple thing, his compassion. My dear brother, my dear sister, number 3, and when the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said unto her, weep not. Said unto her, weep not. The sorrow of that woman, that widow, who lost her only son, only God could understand. Because about that sorrow, in Jeremiah 6:26, God says, O daughter of my people, put on sackcloth and roll in ashes, make mourning as for an only son, most bitter lamentation, for suddenly the destroyer will come upon us. The greatest mourning, the greatest mourning for a woman is the mourning when her only son dies. There is no joy for her. She has to put on sackcloth. When her only son dies, that is also a sudden death. No more joy for her. No more comforts for her. She has to roll on ashes. That mourning, when the only son dies, no more future, no more joy. She has to roll on ashes. It's not that she has got many children, only one son. That one son died. All her joy is lost. All her comforts are lost. And her lamentation is very bitter. Most bitter lamentation, the Bible says. Most bitter lamentation. There may be lamentation for many losses, but the only son died, that lamentation is a bitter lamentation. In Zechariah chapter 12, in verse 10 it says, mourning for an only child, a firstborn, weeping bitterly. Weeping bitterly. A young man was weeping bitterly over the phone. weeping, sobbing and sobbing, weeping bitterly. My dear brother, my dear sister, by nature, I'm not a very emotional person. There are a few occasions in my life I moved into tears. Bitterly, only one occasion, 1990, August 29. The words of some people hurt me deeply. My whole future was bleak before me. I don't know what I'm going to do next. My wife and our two children, where will I go with them? And a greater worry, hundreds of books I got. Where will I keep my books? I know the Lord will not let me down, but what will I do next? The very presence of God, behind my study table, kneeling down, my life was bitter and I know the Lord will not leave me. But the pain was excruciating. I lifted up my eyes to the Lord. The Lord performed a great miracle. My dear brother, my dear sister, in our life, difficult situations come where it will be bitter. In Isaiah 25, verse 8, He will swallow up death in victory. He will swallow up death in victory. He will swallow up all your negative situations in victory. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from off all faces. The Lord will wipe away tears from all faces. And the rebuke, the reproach, or the insult of His people shall He take away from off all the earth. He will take away all the insults, all the reproaches. What all you face on the earth, He will take all reproaches of the earth. It won't be remembered by anybody. The insults, reproaches, comments, hurts, He will wipe away tears from all your faces. For the Lord hath spoken it. Is not Robert Simon speaks it? For the Lord hath spoken it. My dear brother, my dear sister, in the Old Testament it says, the Lord shall wipe away tears from their faces. But let me show you the passage in the New Testament. Revelation 7:17. Revelation 21:4. The Bible says, He will wipe away all tears from their eyes. In Isaiah you read, He will wipe away the tears from your faces. Tears collected in your eyes. Tears started rolling down on your faces. The Lord will surely wipe away the tears from your faces. He said in Isaiah, but in the book of Revelation it is said, He will wipe away tears from your eyes. Even before your tears could roll down on your face, Jesus will wipe away the tears. In the New Testament, God is much closer to us. He is in us. He is for us. He has died for us. He has borne all our sorrows, all our griefs on the cross for you and I. Not from the face. Before our tears could roll down on our face, He will wipe away our tears from our eyes. My dear brother, my dear sister, Jesus saw her, moved with compassion, told her, weep not. Weep not. Many people would have told her, weep not. Don't weep, ma. Don't weep, ma. 1,000 people may say 10,000 times, weep not, weep not, weep not. Can that wipe away her tears? In a dramatic way, I was just imagining that many years back when I was reading this passage. She got married. She was going to Nain. As any other woman, She was just moved to tears from her village. She was going to this new village. The father came near her, wiped her tears and said, "Weep not. Don't weep, ma. Your husband is nice. Your parents-in-law, they are very good people. In that village, there are many of our relatives. Anytime your brother is high, we will come and see you. Don't weep, ma. Don't weep, ma." He wiped away her tears and sent her. Today, that father is not there to wipe her tears away. One day, there was a quarrel between the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law. Mother-in-law said some painful words. This little girl was unable to bear it. When the husband came home, he saw her swollen face, tears and tears. Before he could ask, "What happened?" Tears are rolling down on her cheek. She could not even open her mouth and talk. Slowly she said what her mother-in-law said. He pulled her by side, hugged her, wiped away her tears and said, "Don't weep, ma, don't weep. I am for you. That husband is not there." She didn't want to live anymore. There was a beautiful poem. Home they brought the warrior dead. She has got no hope, no future. Without the husband, 2000 years ago, there was no life for her. There's no more life for her. She saw the little boy. The little boy left in her arms. The image of her husband. The gift of her husband. The reminiscence of her husband. She wanted to live for that boy. So many pains, so many agonies, so many reproaches, so many insults. Her only purpose to live on the earth was for that boy. She could not bear the pain of this dark earth. This little boy was crawling, she was in tears. She climbed her lap, put his tender palm, wiped away her tears. One day the boy, 2 years old, when he saw her mother crying, he said, "Ma, don't weep, ma, don't weep, ma." She took him, hugged him, laughed at him. The only source of joy for her on the earth was that little boy. The boy has become a young man. One day she was in tears. The little boy came to her and said, "Amma, don't weep. All the days of your sorrow is over, are over. No more you are going to be in pain. I'll go to work, ma. How much you suffered to look after me. No more. I'll keep you in a swing. No more this old clothes. I'll buy new clothes for you. Enough, my hands toiled for my sake. I will go. I will yearn. And I will look after you like a queen. Don't weep, ma. Don't weep." That light, that lamp was quenched today. That lamp was quenched. Why should I live? There's no purpose in living. There's no purpose in living. When I was in the college, if I remember carefully, I could say that was the first funeral house I ever entered. One of our friends, he had a sudden death. We meet in parks. We play together. His parents know me very well. When we heard that boy died, we went into that house. As soon as we went in, that mother burst into tears, shouted, "Pa,
ராபர்ட் வந்திருக்கிறான், எலும்பி விளையாட பாப்பா, ராபர்ட் வந்திருக்கிறான், get up and go off to play, ராபர்ட் வந்திருக்கிறான். Till today I remember that. The dead man cannot come back to life. They are taking him to burial. She was going behind the bed with no hope. Probably she would have said, bury me with him. He has gone to a place where there's no return. Why should I come back home? For whom I am going to live anymore? There is no hope for her. There is no light for her. There is no future for her. There is no joy for her. There is no comfort for her. There is no hand to wipe away her tears anymore. All hopes are lost. The light is quenched. Darkness shrouded her. Life is no meaning for her. Living is no purpose for her. Jesus told her, weep not. Verse 14. Something very powerful. And he came. That word came is very powerful in this place in Greek. He came nearer to her. He came forward. He came up. He approached her. And this word is generally used that when we draw closer to God to worship Him. Closer to God to worship Him. It's not that He came. In Tamil it says, Kittavand, he came up, he came forward. When we were young children, our father used to teach us many proverbs. Many of the proverbs in English and Tamil, I still remember. Every morning, my father used to take me to the river Thambravarani for bath. Maybe nearly 1.5 kilo, more than 2 kilometers. Even as a little boy, I was to walk with my father to Thambravarani Aaru River for bath. Even in those days we had tap facility, but I enjoyed going with my father in the morning, walking more than 2 kilometers to Thambravarani Aaru for bath. Those are the days that really shaped me. He talked to me many proverbs. And even today I remember those proverbs. And I was maybe in standard 4 or 5 or 6 at that time. One of the proverbs what my father taught me. When you laugh, the world laughs with you. When you weep, you have to weep alone. I was a little boy, maybe standard 3 or 4. At that time my father taught me, when you laugh, the world will laugh with you. When you weep, you have to weep alone. My dear brother, my dear sister, when we are prosperous, when we are successful, many people will come closer to us. Many people will come and help us. But when you go through the path of sorrow, when you are in your needs, your difficult situations, private situations, others will not come to you. When you know that you have eaten full and you have got sufficient, over sufficient to eat, you go to your house, they'll ask you, "Na brother, saptingla? Yena sister, saptingla?" They know very well you had eaten up. When they know that there's nobody to provide you, when you are in need, when you are in hunger, when you are hungry, there may not be anybody to ask you, "Saptingla?" Because if you say "Saptingla," they have to give you food. They will not ask you. When you are in sufferings, your own friends, your own relatives may not come to see you. When you are very prosperous, everybody will come and say, you are his relative. They will come and say, they are your relatives. You know your uncle, your uncles, aunties, chittappas, thambis, wives, in that way I am related to you. They will come and claim their relationship. But when you are going through the path of sorrow, your own brother may not come to you. This is the world we are living in. Nobody will come nearer to you. Nobody will approach you. Nobody will not move forward towards you. They won't take a step towards you. This is a very powerful word Luke has recorded. He came nearer to her, approached her, went forward to her. From that crowd, he made a gesture. Two processions were meeting. Jesus could stand in his place and send a word. The step that he took forward, moved forward, came nearer to her was powerful. My dear brother, my dear sister, I was imagining like this. This boy died. Somebody from the village of Nain going to that woman's house, to her brother's house, early morning, 4 o'clock, knocking at the door. That man wondering, who is there? Open the door, a young man from village of Nain is come, a town of Nain is come. He asked, hey, what happened, what happened? Your sister, yes, yes, my sister. That her son, what happened to that boy? Suddenly yesterday he died. Wait, wait, I'll come. He goes in. His wife, standing and listening to this, calls him, hey, come here. Where are you going? Enga pora? No, my son's died. My sister's son died. Be quiet. You want to bring that Chani in here? She swallowed up her husband. Now she swallowed up her son. That is a curse on her. If you go there, what will she do? Where will she go? Will she not come with you here? You want to bring the curse here? To come and swallow some of our people? Why do you want to run there? She is a cursed woman. Swallowed up her husband, swallowed up her son. Do you want to go there? Then only for some people, only wife talks wisdom comes. Otherwise they are fools. Only when wife talks wisdom comes. They don't have their own understanding. They really feel sorry for some men. I don't say that you should not listen to your wife. Even when we see advertisement in these days, most of the advertisements project that men are brainless. It's a horrible. The old husband and wife would be sitting. That old man may not know what type of paint should be given. Only the wife will suggest what paint must be given. The husband doesn't know what fridge he should buy. Only wife should say what fridge she should buy. The worst situation, the husband doesn't know in what where to buy the house. Only the wife will say, buy the house from these people. And more than that, the boy doesn't know what bike he should buy. The wife should tell him what bike he should buy. We are living in a world where slowly they are giving a poison, an injection that the man doesn't know anything. It's a type of an evil days to make people believe only women will know everything. I'm not against women, but I want to warn you, this is an end time sign. Seeing this advertisement, man understands, he cannot know what type of a paint they should give. Seeing this advertisement, man understands, he doesn't know where to invest his money. Seeing this advertisement, man understands, he doesn't know where to buy the fridge. Seeing this advertisement, man understands, he doesn't know even to buy his own car. He doesn't know where to buy the dhoti. What type of a dhoti he should buy? That also a woman should say. Why should we have the other culture when we have got our own Tennaga culture? You kattiko. Man doesn't know what type of a dhoti he should buy. Horrible. This is evil. For many men, their brains will be active only when women talks. I'm not against women suggesting good things. The Bible says obey one another. I obey my wife, I'm proud of it. But it is not only, as it said, not only by listening to her alone. My dear brother, my dear sister, when you are in a strait situations, even your wife will not come near it. Your wife will not come near it. Your husband will not come near it. Your own brother will not come near it. His brain started acting. The tube light flashed. Thambi, you nippo na peragu vaare. Because of the pillow teaching. Because of the pillow teaching. Your own brother will not come to help you. My dear brother, my dear sister, for miracle to take place, he will come nearer to you. He came nearer to her. My dear brother, my dear sister, there is a Latin phrase, ex muro motu. Ex means out of. Miro moto. From that only we get the word moto, motive, etc. Ex miro moto means out of his own nature. She didn't ask. She didn't pray. This is a very rare occasion. There are a few occasions where Jesus performed miracles without they are asking. Without they are asking. She didn't pray. She didn't cry unto him. She was not expecting a miracle. Ex maramoto. Out of his own nature, he moved towards her. In this morning, in the name of Jesus, I tell you, if he could move towards her, out of his own nature, when you cry unto him, when you are blood washed, when you are washed by his own blood, when you are anointed with his spirit, when you have made a, when you have got a covenant relationship with him, baptism, will he not come nearer to you? Maybe you are unable to see him. He has got a definite purpose for this delay, for his glory to be revealed. But he will not leave us. He will not forsake us. He came nearer to her. Number 5. And he came and touched the bear. Everything may seem to be simple, but for a Jewish young man, for a rabbi, to touch the bear, it is something totally out of question. When he touches the bear, he would become defiled. When he becomes defiled, he cannot go into the city. He is going into the city. When he touches the bear, he must also move with the dead body to outside the city. He should also move with the dead body outside the city. He cannot go into the city when he touches the bear. My dear brother, my dear sister, but this young Jew, he touched the leper, he touched the bear, he allowed a woman suffering from hemorrhage to touch him. In there are some religions where a woman has got her period, She cannot go to the temple. Because they believe, it's their faith. I'm not questioning their faith. I'm not criticizing their faith. I'm just showing the difference. Their faith, the sanctity of that sanctuary will be defined because of women with their periods going in there. It will defile them. That's what the Old Testament they believed. She is untouchable. She is with a defilement. That's what they also believed. In the Old Testament, they believe she is untouchable. My dear brother, my dear sister, they believe the cleanliness of a man or a person will be defiled if this woman would touch her. If this woman would go to a holy place, that holy place will be defiled. But Jesus, when a defiled woman touched her, he didn't become defiled, she was cleansed. Her bleeding stopped. She was healed, she was made whole, she was made clean. There's a difference. One day I was in a hospital, a very big hospital. That hospital had an image, a statue of one of their gods they worship. Suddenly some pujaris came, they did some puja, and they started covering that statue. This is the first time I saw they are covering that statue. So I asked the people there, why are they covering that statue? The people, the staff there told me, they are going to bring a dead body this way. When they bring a dead body, generally they cover the statue of their God. Again, lovingly I say, I don't criticize their faith. They don't want their God to see the dead body. Jesus saw her, came nearer to her, touched the bear. A Jewish young man will not do it. He held the hands of the daughter of Jairus. He touched her. Jesus was not hesitating to see dead people, to touch them, to hold them by hand, to lift them up. It's enough, he sent a word. The son of the king's man died. He sent a word, he became all right. Jairus' daughter died. He held her by the hand and lifted her up. He went to the graveyard. He is the resurrection. Called out Lazarus to come out. Here he touched the bear. Whenever Jesus could touch us, or when we could touch Jesus, because of his compassion, because of his love, healing virtue, the power of life flows through. Today he is spirit. His word is spirit and life. When that word touches us, that power flows through us. My dear brother, my dear sister, the very touch of Jesus. Many people wanted to touch Jesus. Many a time Jesus touched the people. Where the power of God was released, it's not enough that a touch is essential, but for us to receive that power. The people astonished. A rabbi touching the bear. Oh, he would be unclean for the rest of the day. Those who were carrying the bear, the Bible says, they stood still. It shocked them. And I don't know how many of you ever carried a dead body or a coffin. Anybody here carried a dead body or a coffin? Nobody? Only one brother, two? It'll be very heavy. Generally when they carry the dead body outside the city, not the cot, not the hearse in those days, they will literally run because it's very heavy. At times they will change the person. Four people can, same four people cannot be carried all through the cemetery or the graveyard. Very heavy. So what they should have done, they must have run. It shocked them. A young rabbi, young man, coming nearer to the woman, saying, "Weep not," touching the bear. They stood still. They are astonished. They could not move further. It stunned them. It stunned them. They don't know he was God. They didn't know he was God. Some preacher coming with a big crowd. My dear brother, my dear sister. They stood still. And he said, "Young man, I say unto thee, arise." For a Jew, "I say," it's a word out of their dictionary. Only God could say, "I say." This is why I said in the beginning, the Godhead was in total revelation there. "I say unto you." How can a man say that? For a Jew cannot say that. In the beginning, there was God, there was the Word. That Word was God. That Word was with God. That Word became flesh and dwelt in our midst. That Word, "I say unto thee." "I say unto thee," the word of authority. It's a very simple passage. It's a very powerful passage. Jesus was releasing his authority. Jesus said earlier, "Time will come even when the dead people will hear my voice." Jesus is revealing, the time is come. Even dead people could hear my voice. At that time, John the Baptist was in prison. John the Baptist had his own question, "Who this man is? Is he the Messiah I predicted? Or should I wait for somebody else to come?" This incident was taken to John. When he sent his disciples with this question, Jesus said, "Tell him, lame walk, blind see, deaf hears, dumb speak, even those who are dead are brought back to life." The time is come. The dead people could hear his voice. What an authority! "I say unto you." He didn't see him as a dead man. The world saw him as a dead man. His mother saw him as a dead man. His relatives saw him as a dead man. His friends saw him as a dead man. But Jesus saw him as a young man. You lost your hope in your daughter. You lost your hope in your son. You lost hope in your future. Say everything is dead. It should be only buried. No hope. But Jesus saw him as Lazarus. Jesus saw him as a young man. Jesus speaks to him. Jesus knew he could hear him. Have you lost confidence in your son? Have you lost confidence in your future? In the name of Jesus, I tell you, Jesus can still speak to them. Those who are dead in sin, those who are dead in transgression, those who are dead in worldliness, they could hear the voice of Jesus. There is power in the voice of Jesus. His words are life and spirit. He sent his word and healed the people. He sent his word and made that man alive. Today you are hearing that word. The word that came upon a dead man. That word is coming upon dead situations. There was darkness all over the earth. He sent his word. "Let there be light." The light came. From where the light came? The light came out of darkness. He called out light out of darkness. He said, let there be light. What was there? There was only darkness. He sent his word, let there be light, and there was light, and that light came out of darkness.
My dear brother, my dear sister, I say one more thing before I conclude. He saw her, had compassion on her, said, weep not, came nearer to her, touched the bear, sent its word to the young man, said, young man, arise. And the young man that was dead sat up and began to speak, and began to speak. There's a prophecy to you. When the Lord would bring light in darkness, when the Lord would bring life in a dead situation, that situation will begin to speak volumes. That situation will begin to speak what God can do. The young man sat up and began to speak. And what is great in the latter part, and he delivered him to his mother. After performing this great miracle, Jesus could have asked that little boy, follow me. He has given him life. When I was waiting in the presence of God, the Lord revealed to me something marvelous. The miracle Jesus performs in our lives, not for his benefit, not to earn one more disciple, not to have somebody to go with him for the ministry. The very purpose of that miracle is give that boy back to the mother. He delivered that boy. He'd understand philosophically. He delivered that boy to his mother. That's what we read. He delivered him to his mother philosophically. Now that boy was under his control. He's his possession. He can do anything he wants with that boy. But he delivered that boy. It is he that delivered that boy. It doesn't mean the boy ran to his mother. It doesn't mean the mother took that boy. He has got complete control over that boy, and he delivered that boy to his mother. The Lord is performing a miracle in your life for you to be blessed. Probably it is left to the mother whether she sends him for the ministry or not, whether he goes on, spreads this good news or not. It's how you respond to that miracle. My dear brother, my dear sister, you lost that woman. What is the glorious day in your life? The great joy in your life? Is it your birthday? Or is it your wedding day? Or is it the day that the nurse came and said that you have given birth to your boy child? What is the greatest joy that you ever experienced? Today, if she could alive, she'd say, it's not my birthday. It's not even my wedding day. It's not even the day that my ears hear that a boy child is born unto me. It is the day that I got back what I lost. It's the day that I got back what I lost. Today the Lord wants me to tell you, you'll get back what you have lost. Have you lost your prayer life? Have you lost your ministry? Have you lost your health? Have you lost your love? Have you lost something in your life? Sorrow has surrounded you. You are shrouded with darkness. You have lost something. You have lost something. It is in the control of the Lord, and he wants to deliver that to you, to make your joy complete. Joy unspeakable. Joy that is complete. He wants to give you when you get what you have lost. I just read a couple of verses and I conclude. In Jeremiah 31:17. And there is hope in thine end. The Lord wants me to tell you, stand to your feet. The word of the Lord is coming to you. Stand to your feet. The Lord is speaking to you. And there is hope in thine end. Be in prayerful attitude. God is sending His word. There is power in His word. And there is hope in thine end. Widow of Nain. There is hope in thine end. There is hope. Son, there is hope in your end. Brother, sister, when you think that everything is lost, the Lord wants me to send His word to you. There is hope in thine end. There is hope in thine end. Say the Lord. Say the Lord. That thy children shall come again to their own border. The word of the Lord is coming to you. Very specifically about your children. They'll come to your border. They'll come to their limits. They'll come to their border. Urishanadina marabakaraba. Hallelujah. Not only about your children. Anything that is outside your border, anything that is outside your boundaries, anything that is outside your limitation, things have gone out of the border. Hallelujah, 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 out of the boundaries, hallelujah. In this morning, the Spirit of the Lord is sending His word. Those things shall be brought within thine border. Those things will be brought within thy boundaries. Hallelujah, there is hope in thine end. There is hope in thine end. Your sons will be brought into your border. Your son, O widow of Nain, he will be brought back to your home. He will be brought back to your bosom. He will be brought back to your lifestyle. He will be brought back to your home. Hallelujah. That was a prophecy in Jeremiah chapter 31. Hallelujah. 2000 years ago, it became a news. It became an incident. It became a history in the life of the widow of Nain. It was a prophecy in the days of Jeremiah. I tell you, in the name of Jesus, on this May 26th, it is a news in your life. It is an incident in your life. Your children will be brought into your border. Hallelujah. The word of the Lord is coming to you. Hallelujah. There is hope in the end. Your sons will be brought into their border. Your sons will be brought into their borders. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We worship you, Master God. In Habakkuk chapter 20, chapter 2, verse 16. Habakkuk 2:16. For in that he himself hath suffered, being tempted, tried, he is also succor them, help them that are tempted. In all your sufferings, He suffered with you. In all your sufferings, He suffered with you. He knows the pains. He can understand your situation. He knows the path in which you are going through. He will comfort you. Hebrews chapter 2:18. He will help you. He understands you. Just read one more passage. Isaiah 63:8. For he said, for Jesus says, for the word comes to you, surely they are my people. Surely they are my people. Children that will not lie. Children that will not deal falsely with me. You make mistakes, but you love the Lord. You will not deal with Him falsely. You are His children. Surely they are my people, children that will not lie to me. So I am your Savior. So I am your deliverer. He knows all your weaknesses. He knows all your shortcomings. Like Peter, you may say, Lord, you know everything. And you know that I love you.
You know that I love you in all my situations, Lord. You know that I have forsaken you. You know that I loved Babylon and went away. You know that, Lord, I have done so many things that could pain your heart. Nevertheless, you know that I love you, Lord. In all their affliction, he was afflicted. And the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and in his pity, he redeemed them. And he bare them and carried them all the days of old. I send God's word upon you, and I am going to pray. He sends his word and heals his people. I paraphrase and read this passage. Isaiah 63:8-9. Surely you are God's children. Surely you don't want to deal falsely with the Lord. So he is your savior. So in all your affliction, he is afflicted with you. And the angel of his presence will save you. In his love, in his pity, he will deliver you out of the miry clay, and he will lift you up and carry you through your old age till you become old. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. Fear thou not. I'm just imagining. Just imagining how that woman, Urishan, how that woman, how that widow of Nain returned home from the gate of the city of Nain. You will return home from this place. You will return home from this place. As she returned home from that, from the gate of the city of Nain, you will return home. The church, the worship place, you come to meet the resurrection. You come to meet the hope. You come to meet the star of hope. You come nearer to worship him. He has come nearer to bless you. Bless your people, O Lord. Send your people back home with your heavenly benediction.